So first thing I just want to briefly mention, because I know that midterm is looming, right? I'm going to give you guys sample questions for the midterm exam over the weekend, right? So I'll give you a set of sample essay questions that you can use to study, that you can use to practice. These will not be the exact questions that will be on the exam, but they will be very similar to the questions that are on the exam, right? So they'll at least let you know about the sorts of broad themes that will appear in the essay questions. The essay questions themselves on the actual test will probably be more specific and focused, but this will at least give you a general idea of the sort of thing I'm looking for. Now, have we talked about the format of the exam at all? Have people asked me, okay, then this is as good a time as any to do that. I plan to post those sample questions by Sunday. They'll be in the syllabus and assignment folder on GeorgiaView. If I don't post them by Sunday night, which is entirely possible because I'm poorly organized and slightly forgetful, someone just please send me an email to prod me, right? It's like, hey, I looked for those questions, they weren't there. Right. So the format of the exam, right, it's gonna be in two parts. The first portion will be short essay. I will give you three essay questions. You will choose one, and you will answer it in a reasonably well-developed essay of about 3 to 4 blue book pages. And I will provide blue books for you, right? So you won't have to go to the bookstore and buy those. The second portion of the exam will be IDs and definitions. So I'm going to give you a list of terms, characters, places, concepts, things like that. And there'll be 12, you'll choose 8. You'll give me the text it comes from, or a text it's relevant to, the name of the author of that text, and a short paragraph telling me what it is and why it matters. So some of these texts do not have known authors, right? So in that case, right, if the author of said text is unknown to history, right, then you just write anonymous. You do not do this if the author is simply unknown to you. Right? Unknown to history, not unknown to you. So for, like, say, the Epic of Gilgamesh, right? This would be an anonymous work. For the Odyssey, however, right, the name you give me is Homer. Unless you've just forgotten and you write anonymous, in which case you're still going to lose the point, but, well, go for it.
You said that identify the text. What were the other characteristics?
Yes, you will identify the text, the author, and then just give me a brief definition, right? Just about like a short paragraph, maybe 3 or 4 sentences. Yeah?
You said there are going to be 12 definitions, but we choose 8?
Yes, you'll be given 12 to choose from, and you will choose 8.
Okay.
And I'm not going to give you a study guide for those. For that, go through your notes, right? If there are particular key concepts that we've talked about a lot, right, things that have come up in multiple class periods, they will probably appear on the exam, right? Anything that we spend significant time on in class will probably be on the exam. I will not put anything on the exam that we did not specifically talk about in class. Right, so if it is in your notes, it could very well be on the exam.
Does that count for the essay questions too?
The essay questions, yeah, it's all going to be drawn from thematic stuff we've talked about in class, yeah. And I mean, generally, it's been my experience that if you're coming to class and doing the reading, you do just fine on the exam. Right, so I'm not saying don't study, I'm not saying don't sweat it, I'm not saying take this too easily, but don't freak out about it either, right? Almost all of you have been to every class period. Almost all of you seem to be keeping up, right? If you have specific questions about the exam, if you have specific questions about, what's going to be on it, the format, whatever, then please do come and talk to me. But if anybody has actually any more general questions right now about it, before we jump into Ovid.
Are these going to be equal points? Like when we're talking about the first part being the short essay and the second part being definitions?
The essay is worth more.
Okay.
Essentially, it's 100-point test. The essay, worth a total of 60 points. And the shorthand, the definitions, points, so 5 points each. Right, 1 point for author, 1 point for text, 3 points for definition. That's the breakdown. So, one piece of advice I will give all of you, right? I don't care what order you do this in, as long as it all gets done, but make damn sure that you get the essay done. Because if you screw that up, that is going to hurt you a lot more than if you screw up the definitions. Anything else? All right, well, now that we're all nice and cheerful, let's get back into the text. What did you think of this? How'd this go for you? Who wants to start?
It's familiar.
Okay. I know you've, yeah, I know that you've read this before, yes. Is this familiar at all to anybody else? Are any of you at least familiar with some of these stories? Okay, yeah, so not all of this is going to be brand new to everybody, right?
I kind of had a question about,
yeah,
like on page 1077,
mm-hmm,
the thing that stood out to me,
yeah,
is kind of weird, but it said some god or kinder nature.
Uh-huh.
What are they referring to? Just like the unknown?
Yeah, well, I think, let's actually look at that whole piece together, because it'll make a lot more sense if we look at the whole piece before we try to figure that out, right? I mean this whole little creation story here, right? So, how do these, we've looked at a couple of these, right? How do these creation stories usually work? What seems to be the broad outline of most of them?
Seems to be like a god, and from chaos they build,
yeah,
what is order, basically.
Exactly, yeah, you have, you know, some sort of chaos monster, or some sort of chaotic mass, right? And a god comes in and kills the chaos monster and carves up its body, or shapes that chaotic mass, right, separates it out into various parts and imposes order upon it, right? So most of these kinds of, does anybody remember what we call these kinds of stories? Yes. Yes, cosmogony. Yes, very good, John. Thank you. Yeah, cosmogony is what we call these stories. Right, creation of the universe, creation of the cosmos. And yeah, they all seem to follow that same broad pattern, right? The story in the Enuma Elish, those ancient Egyptian myths, the Greek myth in Theogony, right? Even, you know, the stories in Genesis, right? Follow the same broad pattern. So how is this story similar to those? We see pretty much the same thing happening here, right? Before the seas and lands had been created, before the sky that covers everything, nature displayed a single aspect only throughout the cosmos. Chaos was its name, a shapeless, unwrought mass of inert bulk and nothing more. With the discordant seeds of disconnected elements all heaped together in anarchic disarray. Do we already notice something a little bit different? Does Ovid seem to be spending a little bit more time and devoting a little bit more specificity to this chaos than we're used to?
Yeah, I guess in the other ones it's more implied. Like,
yeah,
like, especially in Genesis, even, it doesn't,
mm-hmm,
really go into detail about what was there.
Yeah, the face of God moves across the waters and all that, right? But apart from knowing that it's wet, right, we don't get much specificity there.
Right.
Yeah, here we get a much more detailed description of chaos. Than we're accustomed to. So that's different. The sun as yet did not light up the earth, nor did the crescent moon renew her horns, nor was the earth suspended in midair, balanced by her own weight, nor did the ocean extend her arms to the margin of the land. Although the land and sea were present, land was unstable, the sea unfit for swimming, and air lacked light, Shapes shifted constantly, and all things were at odds with one another. For in a single mass, cold strove with warm, wet was opposed to dry, and soft to hard, and weightlessness to matter having weight. So this chaos is sort of shaped by conflict, right? All these disparate elements in conflict with each other. Some god, or kinder nature, settled this dispute by separating earth from heaven, and then by separating sea from earth and fluid ether from the denser air. And after these were separated out and liberated from the primal heap, he bound the disentangled elements, each in its place and all in harmony. The fiery and weightless ether leapt to heaven's vault and claimed its citadel. The next in lightness to be placed was air. The denser air drew down gross elements and was compressed by its own gravity, and circling water lastly found its place, encompassing the solid earth entire. Now when that god, whichever one it was, had given chaos form, dividing it in parts which he arranged, he molded earth into the shape of an enormous globe so that it should be uniform throughout. So now we're getting to that weird thing that you noticed, Megan, right? The god who did this is not named. Some god or kinder nature, right? This god, whichever god it was. Why do you think Ovid spends so much time and detail on the chaos, but doesn't name the god that shaped it? What does this suggest about which is actually more important to him?
The chaos.
Yeah, the chaos is what matters here. Some god or kinder nature, right? Whichever one it was, it doesn't matter. It's not all that important to Ovid which god shaped all this. What god bound everything in harmony? Yeah, go ahead.
If it says or kinder nature, though, isn't that even meaning it's dispute on whether or not it's a god or something else?
Yeah.
Like it doesn't even.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who the hell knows what did it? It's meant as a sort of flippant dismissal, right? Now the purpose of this flippant dismissal is clear if we look at the theme that unites the whole of the epic, right? The epic is called the Metamorphoses. We have these disparate little episodes that are only linked by fairly flimsy connections, right? What is the constant theme that runs through all of these stories, though?
Transformation,
change, exactly. Every story in the epic involves some process of transformation. Usually human beings transforming into something else, or other things transforming into human beings, right? Now, why is it that all of these things can change their shapes so easily? What does this suggest about the harmony and the order that some god or kinder nature has imposed upon creation?
It's not true.
Yeah, it's unstable, right? Yeah. Everything is made out of chaos. And because everything is made out of chaos, nothing holds its form forever. All things change into other things with the passage of time. There is actually a political message behind this. So I'm going to tell you a little bit. I don't usually spend too much time on author biography because in most cases I don't think it actually matters all that much. But in Ovid's case, I think it does because it gives us some key to the context that he's working in. So, Ovid is the first major Roman poet to come of age to do all of his work in the reign of Augustus, the first Roman emperor. Now, does anybody know what Rome looked like before it was ruled by an emperor, what their system of government was like?
If I remember correctly, he centralized everything.
Oh, he centralized the hell out of things, yeah.
Like, it used to be, like, more...
Yeah. Yeah, it was a republic. So the Roman Republic... was ruled by a body of senators. The majority of whom were drawn from the patrician class. The patrician class was the upper class, ordinary people, that is, you know, the great masses of Romans were called plebeians. The Senate was overseen by two consuls. Who were elected sort of like how our senators don't go up for re-election in the same year, right? Consuls didn't come up for re-election in the same year either. They were chosen not by the people, but by the Senate. So prior to Augustus taking power, two consuls were elected who found themselves at odds with each other. Right, one who's known to history as Pompey was an aristocratic conservative.
Is that how many consuls there were? Only two?
There were usually only two. Sometimes there was a triumvirate. And the triumvirate is even more unstable than the duo. But the major conflict is between these two figures, Pompey, the aristocratic conservative, and one Gaius Julius Caesar,
later came to create the combination of the church and state. He eventually ends up being the...
He's deified after his death. Yeah.
Like he,
yeah, and it's actually Augustus who does that. It's Augustus who deifies Gaius Julius Caesar, who was his uncle. And Caesar was a populist, right? He wasn't elected by the people. None of the senators, consuls, they weren't chosen by the people, right? Consuls were chosen by the Senate. These two gentlemen don't see eye to eye for fairly obvious reasons. And they go to war against each other, right? They both muster armies to drive each other out of Rome. So we have, all right, Roman Civil War, part one, right? Promising sequels. Caesar's party drives Pompey's party out. Pompey is killed. Caesar then declares himself dictator. So he declares himself sole ruler of Rome using emergency powers of the consul. A group of senators led by Marcus Brutus and Caius Cassius oppose him. And they lead their party to assassinate Caesar in the Senate on the 15th of March in, I don't recall off the top of my head what year. The specific year doesn't matter. So here we begin Roman Civil War Part 2. As Brutus and Cassius gather their followers to face Caesar's protege, Marcus Antonius, and his nephew, Octavian. Marcus Antonius, so this is Roman Civil War Part 2. Marcus Antonius and Octavian defeat Brutus and Cassius. Roman Civil War Part 2 comes to an end. But we see a fairly predictable pattern emerging here, right? What do you think is likely to happen then between Marcus Antonius and Octavian?
Probably end up having a war
against someone else. Not against someone else. Against each other. Right, a power struggle ensues between these two, and Octavian eliminates Marcus Antonius, who commits suicide in Egypt. And so Octavian is left sole ruler of Rome. He renames himself Augustus and declares that Rome is now an empire, not a republic, under his sole control, under his sole rule.
I thought Caesar did that because I thought Caesar made it the Holy Roman Empire.
The Holy Roman Empire is a completely different kettle of fish entirely. Oh. The Holy Roman Empire was where Germany now is.
Okay.
That was the kingdom that was founded by Charlemagne.
Oh, that's
it's
right.
Neither holy nor Roman nor actually really an empire. So yeah, Octavian becomes Augustus, and by now you've had about 30 years of chaos, right? And what Augustus wants in his new realm is stability. Right, let's end all of this infighting, let's end all this war and chaos. Let's promote stability. As a result, well, in order to aid himself in this endeavor anyway, he promotes a concept that he calls eternal Rome. This is borrowed from an old Roman Republican idea that Rome would never fall as long as its people continued to work for its glory. What Augustus imagines, though, is Rome is a stable and constant center of power and authority. And he models his image of Rome on a certain model of the family, right? He essentially sort of transfers the Greek concept of the oikos, the well-ordered household, into a Roman idiom, right? He calls it domus.
Right.
Domus in Latin simply means house or home. Basically same thing as oikos. Any of you ever seen The Life of Brian? Monty Python movie? No? Then the joke would be lost on you. All right, then never mind. Okay, so... The Roman home under Augustus is led by a strong father figure who is possessed of the quality of virtu or manliness. Right, we can see here, actually, this is the roots of our word virtue. Our word virtue actually comes from this gendered Roman term, believe it or not. And in order to display virtu, right, there are a couple of components to this. The most important is pietas, which translates roughly to piety or duty. Right, your duty to the Roman state and to the Roman people is more important than anything else in your life under Augustus. So he promotes this idea by patronizing artists who promote it. Right? He promotes this idea by trying to turn his own family into a model of this. This doesn't actually work out so well. The figure that's used primarily to promote this is the epic hero Aeneas. Now Aeneas is the primary protagonist of an epic by the poet Virgil an older and more conservative contemporary of Ovid's called perhaps unsurprisingly, the Aeneid. Now, if we look at the old Greek epics on which the Aeneid was modeled, right, there are a couple of important differences. First, those were born largely out of oral tradition. Right, you've got poets who took traditional stories and melded them together into a continuous narrative. Roman epics, on the other hand, are purely literary creations. They are not based on oral tradition. They are based on pre-existing literature. So they're always a written tradition. The nature of the hero is different here as well. If we think about heroes like Odysseus or Achilles, are these people who really give a shit about other people? Only insofar as those other people are useful to them, right? By and large. The Roman hero is a completely different kettle of fish. Aeneas is defined mostly by his devotion to duty. It is his destiny to get his people to Italy, where they will found a city that will become Rome. And he's not even doing this for himself. He's doing it so that his son will one day be king. Along the way, he discards a promising romantic relationship because pursuing it would distract him from his destiny. Right? At various points, he wants to stop, and the gods appear and say, no, you go on, pursue your destiny. And he always listens, he always obeys. The Roman hero is defined by his devotion to duty. At least from the Augustan age on. Now, the other thing to note about Aeneas he's a Trojan prince. He and his men are the last survivors from the siege at Troy. So they sail across the Mediterranean to found a new city. The reason for this, right, what Virgil is trying to do is link Rome to an earlier civilization to display a kind of cultural continuity. Right? No, we are not barbaric upstarts who just built this city here in the Tiber River Valley. We are actually the continuation of an old and great society. We are eternal Rome, right? Rome has always been, even when it was Troy. So the image that we usually see of Aeneas promoted in artwork is, and, you know, again, I apologize for not being a very good artist. We see an adult man in the prime of life with an old man, his aged father, sitting on his shoulders, right? Even big, long, furry beard there, a couple of wisps of hair. Leading a little child, his son, by the hand. We see this in vase paintings, we see this in statues, we see this reproduced all over Augustan Rome. Right, so it is the duty of the strong, virile adult man to take care of the preceding generation, right, be a comfort to your aged parents, and be an inspiration and a guide to the generation coming up. So this is the official version of Rome at the time that Ovid is writing. Does this look to you, based on what you've read for today, like Ovid's version of Rome? A couple of you are shaking your heads. Why not? What have we already noted about Ovid's interests and concerns? Pardon?
Chaos.
Yeah. This is all about chaos, right? The base building block of creation in Ovid's cosmogony is chaos. So any attempt to impose order on this is doomed to fail, right? You can build your nice, happy, little orderly society and expect everybody to follow on, expect everything to go harmoniously, and it's going to fall apart. Because change is inevitable. Right? Stability is unnatural.
So he's kind of making a political statement almost. Like,
that, yeah.
You know, you might try, but...
Yeah. Attempts to impose order are always fleeting. Now, Ovid, this is where his biography comes into this, was exiled from Rome in the year 8 of the Common Era to a city called Tomes in what is now Romania. So he was exiled to like the very, this very sophisticated, cultivated urban court poet who was sent out to essentially cultural Siberia, right? It's like if you took, a prominent New York City-based author whose whole subject matter is social life in the city and forced him to move to the middle of Alaska. No one in Tomes spoke Latin. Ovid did not speak their language, so he couldn't communicate with anyone around him. He was always writing letters back to Rome about how he could no longer live among these shaggy barbarians. You know, please, please, please intercede with the emperor to bring me home. But the one thing that we don't know for certain is what he actually did to get exiled. There are a number of theories about this. For example, he wrote a satirical seduction handbook called the Ars Amatores that tweaked the emperor's nose a little bit by suggesting that Roman sexual morals were not, in fact, chaste and prudent, as Augustus claimed, but that traditionally people's sexual morality was really pretty loose. But those were circulating for a couple of years by the time he got exiled. It was actually the Metamorphoses that had just started circulating when he got sent off to Tomes. So I would suggest that it might actually have been something in this work that, in fact, enraged the emperor against him. What else do you guys notice in this? Like, what else seems to you interesting or important here? Were there any particular, apart from this creation story, are there any particular episodes that interested you or stood out to you?
Yeah, there was a lot of like gods chasing women, and they always got caught or turned into cows or turned into fountains.
Yeah.
There was a lot of like rape where they were stolen.
a lot of gods imposing their will forcefully on basically defenseless women. So that's largely a feature of the first two books of the Metamorphoses. It's in 15 books, and there is actually a sort of plan to its organization, right? It's not, as we saw, a continuous narrative. The first part, right, books 1 and 2, deal mostly with relationships between gods and mortals. Books 3 through 6 deal mostly with mortals breaking the rules. Books 7 through 11 are mostly about tragic love. And books 12 through 15 deal with Roman history. and it actually ends with what looks like an attempt to make up to Caesar by sort of showing Julius Caesar going up into the sky and becoming a god and a star, right? So it ends with the deification of Julius Caesar. But yeah, these first two books about gods and mortals, and gods imposing their will on mortals, right? We get two samples of that. We get the Apollo and Daphne story, and the Jove and Io story. So let's start with Apollo and Daphne. What's the basic outline of this? How did this go?
But it's kind of his fault. Like, it's kind of Apollo's fault he got shot by Cupid, because he was a jerk, and so Cupid was teaching him a lesson.
Yeah, so let's look at what each of those gods then represents, right? So Apollo is the god of what? Does anybody know? He's not actually the... Helios is the actual sun.
I thought he was the god of, like, Mars or something.
The god of... Pardon?
No, it's like Mars or something.
Mars is a... Yeah, music is one of a part of Apollo's purview. Mostly because music is based on math. And Apollo is primarily a god of reason and logic.
He wasn't being very reasonable or logical.
No, yeah, he's boasting
right
to Cupid about his recent accomplishment, right? And what is the recent accomplishment that he is so proud of?
Great victory against Python.
Yes. He has killed a monstrous serpent in order to found his little sanctuary at Delphi, right? Which is where the oracle would sit and take lots of magic mushrooms, and people would come to her and get confusing prophecies. So, what Apollo has done is essentially sort of like a miniature version of one of those old cosmogonic myths, right? He's taken a chaos monster, he's killed it, and he's imposed order on the part of the world that it controls. So he's fresh off of a kind of mini cosmogony. Right, an establishment of order. And what about Cupid? What does Cupid represent?
The god of sexual desires.
Yeah. Cupid is the god who kindles lust and sexual desire. Either with his little torches or with his golden arrows. As we see, he is also capable of making sexual desire leave a person, right? With his lead arrows. So, Cupid represents a force that is, by its very nature, kind of disorderly, right? He represents a force that is chaotic and capricious. Something that is more likely to cause conflict and disorder than it is to cause order and harmony. And indeed, because he fires his arrows across purposes here, that's exactly what he does. He subjects the god of reason and logic to chaotic emotions that will be left unfulfilled. So the argument between them is essentially one over supremacy, right? Who's better? You look at the bottom of page 1079. What are you doing with such manly arms, lascivious boy? That bow befits our brawn, wherewith we deal out wounds to savage beasts and other mortal foes unerringly. Just now, with our innumerable arrows, we managed to lay low the mighty python, whose pestilential belly covered acres. Content yourself with kindling love affairs with your wee torch, and don't claim our glory. The son of Venus answered him with this: "Your arrow, Phoebus, may strike everything. Mine will strike you. As animals to gods, your glory is so much the less than mine." So I'm going to write you a piece of shit. I'm going to brag about your accomplishments going, Python, show you. Shoot, shoot, right? So the chaotic god is the greater, right? Is the more powerful. He is able to send Apollo into a stupid and humiliating frenzy. Humiliating because ultimately unfulfilled, right?
He still loves it even in the tree.
Yeah.
Like, that makes sense.
Well, that's the thing, is that love doesn't make any sense. That's part of the point, right? It's something, it defies logic. It's something that scrambles reason and logic. I mean, it's fairly ridiculous for a god, for an extremely important and powerful god, to be chasing after a nymph who wants nothing to do with him, boasting about all of his accomplishments as he does so, right? Why are you running away from me? I did all this great stuff. Right? I'm a god. Come back. So he can only possess her after she's been changed, right? He can only take any kind of possession of her after she's been changed into a tree. So it's questionable whether or not changing her into a tree actually protects her from the god. Right? Because remember, it's her father who changes her, and her father wanted her to fulfill her daughterly duties and produce grandchildren, right? So what does Apollo do once she becomes a tree? What's his response?
That he's still gonna love her. I mean, he said, "You can't be my bride, but you will surely be my own tree."
Uh-huh. So he claims the laurel then is his sacred tree. Loving her still, the god puts his right hand against the trunk, and even now can feel her heart as it beats against the new bark. He hugs her limbs as if they were still human, and then he puts his lips against the wood, which even now is adverse to his kiss. Right, so this is creepy, right? This is really friggin' creepy. Right, he's fondling the tree even as the bark is shrinking away from him. Right, Daphne can't really resist him anymore. "Although you cannot be my bride," he says, "you will assuredly be my own tree, O laurel, and will always find yourself girding my locks, my lyre, and my quiver too. You will adorn great Roman generals when every voice cries out in joyful triumph along the route up to the Capitol. You will protect the portals of Augustus, guarding on either side his crown of oak. And as I am, perpetually youthful, my flowing locks unknown to the barber's shears, so you will be an evergreen forever, bearing your brilliant foliage with glory." Phoebus concluded. Laurel shook her branches and seemed to nod her summit in assent. So he takes her branches, and they become a symbol of what? What does the laurel crown become a symbol of?
Victory.
Yeah. The irony here, right, is that the crown of victory is taken from a failure. So Ovid's little story here is mocking the great Roman tradition of victory and awarding laurel crowns to victorious poets and to victorious generals, right? It's like, you realize that thing that you're putting in your heads is a symbol of a god's failure, is a symbol of a god's inability to get what he wanted. The attitude towards the gods in general, would you say that this is a pious and reverent poet? Yeah, how does he seem to present the gods by and large?
Foolish.
Yeah, foolish, right? Apollo certainly makes himself ridiculous in this myth, right?
Mm-hmm.
What about in the Jove and Io myth? How is Jove, Jupiter, the king of the gods, the great thunderer and his golden throne in the sky, represented?
Hypocritical.
Okay, why would you say hypocritical? What about his behavior is hypocritical?
Well, because, don't the gods want the humans to be never mind.
Yeah, he's certainly not a model for behavior, right? So if Augustus wants to promote piety and reverence for the gods, right, then you would imagine that the gods would be models for upstanding, upright citizens. But here, right, Jove is, on the one hand, a rapist, right, who essentially kidnaps a girl and forces himself on her. And then does what else? He turns into a cow.
That's watched over by the cat.
Yeah, Argus the Hundred-Eyed Watchman, right? Why does he turn this poor girl into a cow?
So he can give it to his wife.
Yeah, he does it because he's afraid of his wife. So this particular story is not just undercutting the morality of the gods, but also undercutting their power and majesty as well, right? Jove is not just a hypocrite, he's presented as unmanly, right? He is not possessed of virtu, right? He's a henpecked husband who is afraid of his wife. Now it's, I'm sorry? Henpecked. Yes. Now it is also important what he changes her into, what he changes Io into.
Right. He doesn't just change her into a cow, he changes her into a heifer. Does anybody know, what's a heifer?
Baby cow.
Pardon? Yeah, it's a female cow who is not yet calved, right?
Now, the reason this is important is that the heifer was also the most common sacrificial animal in Roman religious rites. Right, we see later in the Pygmalion story, right, the heifers buckling under the death blow, right?
Yeah, heifers are sacrificed to the gods for various favors, right? In the Roman state religion, we still have that mostly transactional relationship between human beings and gods, right? You prayed to the gods because you wanted something from them. Again, usually to get them to leave you alone. So, I think this actually kind of makes a good sort of transition point to the Pygmalion story. We've seen how Ovid goes ahead and makes the gods look fairly ridiculous. What'd you make of the Pygmalion story? Page 1104. Right, we're not concerned anymore with the, at least directly for the moment, with the love affairs of the gods. We're looking here now strictly at human beings. What's Pygmalion's problem? What's this guy's issue?
He's fallen in love with a statue he created.
Yeah, he hates women, but has made a beautiful statue that he's fallen in love with. Pygmalion observed how these women lived lives of sordid indecency, and dismayed by the numerous defects of character nature had given the feminine spirit, stayed as a bachelor, having no female companion. During that time, he created an ivory statue, a work of most marvelous art, and gave it a figure better than any living woman could boast of.
and promptly conceived a passion for his own creation. You would have thought it alive, so like a real maiden, that it's only only its natural modesty kept it from moving. Art concealed artfulness. Pygmalion gazed in amazement, burning with love for what was in likeness of body. All right, and he fondles his statue, he gives it presents, he treats it basically like a real girlfriend. Right, it's like, how many of you have seen those, you know, sort of cartoons where you got sort of the pathetic nerdy dude who makes like a girl robot? This is the ancient Roman equivalent of that, right? Pygmalion has made himself a girl statue. And he prays to Venus to bring her to life. And it seems like all is well then, right? Everything's great, everything's hunky-dory. Girl statue comes to life, they marry, they have kids. So it seems like Pygmalion wins through the intervention of Venus. So Pygmalion and statue produce this daughter, Paphos, who then has a son, Cinyras. And then what interesting thing happens to this son?
He has a daughter and he impregnates his daughter.
Yeah. His daughter conceives for him an unnatural passion and uses deception to work her way into his bed.
Okay, just to make sure I'm understanding this correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Paphos is the son of the two of them.
Is the daughter of Pygmalion and his statue, yep.
Okay, and then Cinyras is the son?
Cinyras is the son of Paphos,
okay.
Yep. And Mira is the daughter of Cinyras. So, from this unnatural passion is born a son, Adonis, who in, perhaps, you know, in memory of his unnatural line of heritage, rather than being born, comes flying out of tree bark as his mother has been transformed into a tree. And he himself then becomes the consort of Venus, who set the whole thing in motion in the first place. So, Adonis's death is particularly important to understanding this whole little scheme. Right, if we look on page 1115, Venus tries to convince Adonis not to go hunting. And after warning him, she went off on her journey, carried aloft by her swans, but his courage resisted her admonitions. It happened that as his dogs followed a boar they were tracking, they roused it from where it was hidden. And when it attempted to rush from the forest, Adonis pierced it, but lightly, casting his spear from an angle. With its long snout, it turned and knocked loose the weapon stained with its own blood, then bore down upon our hero, and, as he attempted to flee for his life in sheer terror, it sank its tusks deep into the young fellow's privates and stretched him out on the yellow sands, where he lay dying. So what is important here is not so much simply that Adonis is killed. What is important here is the way he dies. What does the boar do to him?
It kills the hunter.
Oh, the boar kills him all right, right?
I mean, he also, like,
castrates.
Exactly, yes. The boar castrates him. The idea here is a sort of nature rebelling against this unnatural line, right? Descended from an inanimate object. Descended from a statue. Right. Statue gives birth to human children. Human children perform monstrous act of incest. Result of monstrous act of incest isn't just killed, but is stopped from reproducing in any way. And who's ultimately punished by this? Yeah. Ultimately, this comes back onto the gods. Venus, who started this whole thing in motion in the first place by granting Pygmalion his wish to marry one like his statue. So yeah, all of this comes back around on her. So continuing this general theme of irreverence and impiety in the epic. I think we're running short on time. Does anybody have any questions about any of this or about anything at all? And this is basically, this is what I consider important enough for you to go with as far as this is concerned. So I think we have another presentation next time, right? The Bhagavad Gita group will be presenting. I have some guide questions for you. Don't forget to turn in your in-class writings. I will see you next Tuesday.